Okay, let us start the second talk of the morning session. And our speaker is Veronique Terrasse from Saclair. And she's going to talk about correlation functions of the XXZ open spin chain with unparalleled boundary fields. Please.
So thank you very much. And I would really like to thank the organizer of this very nice workshop. It is really a pleasure to be here, especially after these 2 years of COVID, which were a little bit difficult. So what I will try to explain you today is based on some joint work with Giuliano Nicoli, but more than this specific work, I would like also to make a kind of review of what is known and not known for this specific type of model. The model I'm considering is a usual XXZ spin chain. But instead of considering a periodic boundary condition, where is the pointer? Not working. It's here. Instead of considering periodic boundary condition, I'm considering an open chain with a boundary field. And a priori, I can consider any type of boundary field at site 1 and site n along the three possible directions. So just to settle the notation, here the anisotropy parameter will be parameterized by the parameter eta here. And the boundary field will be parameterized by six different boundary parameters that will be either this set of parameters with this parametrization here, or alternatively, this set of parameters. Here you may replace parameter zeta and kappa by this parameter phi and psi, depending on what kind of equation you obtain. But this parameter can parameterize you the more general boundary fields. And by a little remark is that, of course, you have some invariance of the Hamiltonian under some change of this parameter. For instance, if you put a minus sign here, or also if you reverse the order of the spin and you invert, you exchange the two boundaries, this is also an invariance of the Hamiltonian. And the question that we want to ask is the following. What can we say about the correlation function of local operators at zero temperatures? It means that we consider a product of any local operator or local spin operators in the chain, and you want to compute its mean value in the ground state. So what is known so far? There exists some exact formula in the particular case where the boundary fields are oriented along the z direction, along the anisotropy direction of the chain. The first result were obtained by Jimbo Miwa and collaborators in 1995. They consider the infinite chain and they solve it by the Q-vertex operator approach, and they managed to find some multiple integral representation for the correlation function. And later on, this problem was also considered within the algebraic better on that framework, so starting from the finite chain. And the same type of multiple integral representation could be obtained in the thermodynamic limit. So, yes.
What does it mean, thermodynamic limit?
Thermodynamic limit means that I will make the number of spin sites of the chain tends to infinity. This n here will tend to infinity.
And so are you looking at correlation function far away from the boundaries? Or?
What I'm interested in are the correlation function close to the first site of the chain. Okay. So that we can see the effect of the boundaries on this correlation function.
Only on one boundary?
So somehow it's a half-infinite chain limit. So this last chain, last site n will be sent to infinity, and we start from the third site and we consider correlation function close to the first site of the chain. What we wanted to do recently with Giuliano was to try to generalize this kind of formulas, result, to more general and boundary fields, no longer along the z direction and no longer parallel with each other. So since this is a very difficult problem, I will explain you why. We started by a first case in which is simpler, in which the boundary which will be far away in the thermodynamic limit at infinity, which we still keep it diagonal, so we fix it to a specific value, but we want to have the boundary field on the first site completely arbitrary, so that indeed if we consider this correlation function next to the first site, we can see the effect of this arbitrary field on the expression of the correlation function. Before jumping to this difficult case, I want maybe to make a review of what was known about correlation function already in the periodic case, so that we can understand really the difficulties that arise in the open case. And also to fix the notation. So I remind you that the periodic case is solvable in the framework of the quantum inverse scattering method. And the solution is based on what we can call the representation theory of the Young-Baxter algebra. It means that you consider the generator of this algebra to be the element of some monodromy matrix. And the commutation relation of these four generators that I denote here A, B, C, D are given by this RTT relation, which involves the R matrix of the model, which here is the usual six-vertex R matrix. And there is some abelian subalgebra, which is generated by the transfer matrix, the trace of the monodromy matrix. And the Hamiltonian belongs to this abelian subalgebra. And in the periodic case, you can construct the eigenstate of the transfer matrix and hence of the Hamiltonian by usual algebraic Betterandsatz constructions. It means that you consider the multiple action of the off-diagonal element here B and C of the monodromy matrix on the particular reference state, which in the periodic case is the state with all spins up. So this reference state has to satisfy this condition. And this kind of states are called beta states. These beta states, they are eigenstates of the transfer matrix if the set of parameters satisfied the beta equation. In that case, I will call them on-shell beta state. And otherwise, if the parameters are arbitrary, I will call this beta state off-shell beta states. So what is known about correlation function in the periodic case? So in fact, a lot of things have been done, for instance, in the algebraic Betterandsatz framework. There have been quite precise numerical results, for instance, due to the group of Jean-Sébastien Coe. And there have been also very precise analytical derivation of the correlation function and of their large distance asymptotic behavior starting from the microscopic expression of the correlation function. And you had a flavor of this kind of derivation with the talk of Carole the other day. And what is important to know is that both these approaches, in fact, they are based on some previous analytical result. For instance, considering a two-point function at zero temperature, mean value in the ground state, you can decompose it as a sum over more elementary quantities, these matrix elements, which are called the form factors. And these form factors, they have some very nice representation in the algebraic Betterandsatz framework for the finite chains. They can be represented in a compact form as some determinant of our simple function. And how you obtain this kind of determinant? There are two important ingredients to obtain them. First, you should be able to with this little spin local spin operators on one of the beta states here. And to do that, you can use some very compact reconstruction formula of local operators in terms of the generators of the Young-Baxter algebra. For instance, this sigma minus operator, it can be reconstructed as the B operator dressed by some product of transfer matrices. So when you consider this kind of simple matrix element with two eigenstates here, this is very simple because these transfer matrices, the action of these transfer matrices gives only a numerical factor. And then you remain just with one single, the matrix of element of one single operator to compute, which you can do by using the known commutation relation of the algebra. And then you end up with some sum over some scalar product between some on-shell and off-shell beta state. And what is also very important is that you have some very nice and compact determinant representation for such scalar products. So it was already obtained long time ago by Nikita Slavnov. And basically, you can write this determinant representation as some Jacobian of the transfer matrix eigenvalue here. So this is for the periodic case. Now, what is known for the open case? So in the open case, there is also some nice algebraic framework, which was settled by Sklianin in 88. And you have to consider no longer the usual Young-Baxter algebra, but what is called usually the reflection algebra or boundary Young-Baxter algebra. This is still an algebra that can be defined in terms of generator and relation. The generator, there's the element of some monodromy matrix that I will denote differently from the previous one with this calligraphy Q here, because it's what is called the boundary monodromy matrix, but it's still a 2x2 matrix of generators. So I've written here. And the commutation relation are given by the reflection equation, which I wrote here. So it still involves the same R matrix of the six vertex model. But you see that this equation is slightly more complicated. And in particular, the most general scalar solution of this reflection equation were already found quite a long time ago by these two groups of people. And it takes the following form. So you see that it depends on three different parameters, zeta, kappa, and tau. And I wrote the form here, in addition to the spectral parameter lambda and to the parameter eta, which parametrizes the anisotropy of the model. So from these scalar matrices, you can in fact define two boundary matrices, K minus and K plus, with two sets of boundary parameters, which can in fact parametrize the most general boundary fields at the two ends of the chain. So a little remark here, I just inverted the sign. Usually it's K minus, it's written in terms of zeta minus, kappa minus, tau minus, and K plus also. Well, it's not a misprint, is that it's because in our paper we had to make some kind of technical trick. Okay, but never mind. It's not very important. It's just to avoid to write something wrong on the slides. So what you have to know is that you have these two boundary scalar matrices that describes you the two boundary fields at the two boundaries of the chain. So I remind you the expression of the boundary field, and you can construct a representation explicitly this boundary matrix U in terms of the bulk one. This T was the bulk. This T is this one for the periodic chain, which I call the bulk monodromy matrix. So you can construct this for the spin chain. You can construct the boundary monodromy matrix as this product involving the bulk monodromy matrix, and here this transformation, and the one of the two boundary matrix, for instance, K minus here. So it's still a 2x2 matrix, but the operator, the boundary operator here, are different from the bulk one, so I will denote them with calligraphic letters here. And you still have some abelian subalgebra, which is generated by the transfer matrices, and in the boundary case, they are defined in this way. You take the trace of this boundary monodromy matrix built with K minus with the other scalar boundary matrix K plus, and you can show that they indeed commute between themselves, and you can recover you can obtain the XXZ Hamiltonian from some derivative of the transfer matrix evaluated at some special point. So it's a nice algebraic framework, and you can try to do the same algebraic Bethe-Ansatz construction as in the or similar algebraic Bethe-Ansatz construction as in the periodic case. And this works quite well when both boundary matrices are diagonal. It means that the corresponding boundary fields are oriented only along the z direction, along the anisotropy of the chain. In this case, is that the usual reference state of the period is still a reference for the boundary problem, and you can still use it to construct better states in this way, but this time with this boundary operator B and C. And the machinery works well, so this was already in the paper of Sklianin. And you can also compute the scalar product of this the beta state and the dual one here, one of shell, one of shell, in this boundary case with a diagonal boundary condition. This is a result of Wang based on some previous result of Tsuchiya for the partition function, the corresponding partition function of the model. But the difficulties is that, of course, compared to the periodic case, we lose the translation invariance of the model. So the simple generalization of the reconstruction of local spin operators in terms of the generators of the this time of the young, boundary Young-Baxter algebra, the element of the boundary monodromy matrix, then this kind of formula, simple formula, do not exist in the boundary case, except at site one. At site one, it's work, but when you want to translate them on the chain, remember that in the bulk case, there were just a tracing of transfer matrices, bulk transfer matrices. Here, in the boundary case, we don't know such formula, and there is a good reason for that. It's, of course, that we lose the translation invariance, so the boundary transfer matrix is no longer a translation operator. So this is problematic, since due to that we do not have, although we have a scalar product formula, a nice scalar product formula, we do not have simple closed formula for the form factors as in the periodic case. Nevertheless, it is possible to compute the correlation function, not in a so nice way, unfortunately, as in the periodic case, but in the form of this multiple integral in the thermodynamic limit that I already mentioned. So in the algebraic Bethe-Ansatz framework, this was done in 2007, and the strategy was the following. Since we don't have a good reconstruction in terms of boundary Young-Baxter operators, we used the reconstruction in terms of the bulk one. And I remind you that the boundary monodromy matrix could be expressed in terms of the bulk one in this case. So this boundary B operator, which is used to construct the beta states, you can decompose it in terms of bulk Young-Baxter generators. So you can decompose these boundary beta states into just bulk beta states, and then you can act with the bulk with the known formula for the reconstruction of local operators in terms of the generator of the bulk Young-Baxter algebra on this bulk beta state. And at the end, you obtain some formula in which it is possible to reconstruct the boundary states. And so you obtain a multiple sum over this kind of scalar product. And at the end, when you take the half infinite chain limit, you obtain a multiple integral formula. So this is a way for the what we can do in the diagonal case. So now what about the non-diagonal case? So then the problem is much more complicated, and there are many things that are not known yet. So first of all, what is known? What is known is that it is possible to generalize the usual Bethe-Ansatz equation to some case where the boundary fields are not along the, no longer along the z-direction. But nevertheless, for this generalization to hold, you have to impose one condition between the six boundary parameters, and this condition can be written in this way. So this is a result of Nepomucci in 2003. And you see that this condition involves the six boundary parameters. It's also involved the number of sites of the chain N, and M here would be the number of beta roots. And this epsilon here is some freedom due to some possible choice of different sign. So the problem is that this solution is not complete in general, so it does not give, it cannot give the complete set of the complete spectrum, except in a very particular case where M, number of beta root, is equal to N, then you can show that you can get the complete spectrum. But this case is not very interesting when you want to consider the thermodynamic limit, because if you do that, you still have some dependence of N inside the constraints. So you cannot take the thermodynamic limit by keeping these constraints. So what would be interesting is to have M of the order of N over 2 with some finite deviation, because in that case you can get rid of N inside the constraint. Yes?
To my understanding, complete two set.
Yeah, I will just mention it.
Okay.
So, yes, so there is a result, not a, a conjecture, by Ravanini and Nepomucci, is that if you consider, in fact, two different sectors of M, and you play with this sign here, which means that you kind of play with the symmetry of the chain. The conjecture, which is based on numerical simulation, is that in fact you can in fact recover the complete spectrum. But it's, at the moment, as far as I know, it is only a conjecture.
No, okay, I think it's not a conjecture.
Yeah, based on numerical result. And also it involves that some difficulties, because you have to play with two different sectors, so some and two different construction of the beta state if you manage to construct them. So then to go to correlation function, maybe it's not the, at least the ideal, but okay. Indeed, there is a conjecture about that. So this is for the spectrum. And what about the beta state? So this was derived from analytic arguments. And now some people try to construct the corresponding beta states corresponding to this solution of Bethe-Ansatz equation. And the argument in this first paper was to, in fact, use the analog of the Baxter vertex IRF transformation that was used by Baxter to solve the 8-vertex model by mapping it to a phase model describing the interaction of some height around the face of a lattice model. By using this kind of generalized gauge transformation, you can simplify the problem. I will explain a little bit more later how. And they managed to construct some better states in this way. But there is a problem. So there is a first problem due to the completeness of the solution. The second problem, and which is maybe more problematic for the correlation function, is that you have to impose some constraints when doing that, which are basically Nepomachi's constraint. But when you want to construct your set of beta states in the direct space and then in the dual space, you don't arrive exactly with the same kind of constraints. And so that when you want to compute correlation functions, then this is a problem because you cannot go on with the procedure. And what about more general boundaries? So in that case, the usual Betanzas solution is missing. So there have been several interesting proposals about that. First of all, the proposal by this group of people was to add some kind of additional term to the Better equation. So this is what they call off-diagonal Betanzas. So as to be able to still have some Better equation, but that would have a more complicated form in this case. Then for the construction of the corresponding beta state, you have to rely on some of the approach. For instance, there was a proposal by Béliard, Crampé and collaborator to modify the B operator in such a way that you can still construct some beta states. It's a construction which is quite complicated in the general case, but you obtain a description of the spectrum in terms of this off diagonal Betanzas equation in that case. And finally, there is also a proposal to use separation of variable, which can be also used in this case of constraints. And starting from the work of Fram and collaborators when they consider the XXX chain, and then starting from the work of Giuliano Nicoli and later on with several collaborators when they consider the XXZ chain. And this is what I will explain now. So for those who don't know at all the method, well, I don't know whether, okay, I will be completely late probably. Well, because I'm not at all. Okay. I wanted to give a first idea, general idea of the method. So the goal is to identify a basis of the space of state. In which the spectral problem of the transfer matrix, which is in principle n-dimensional spectral problem, which reduce into a set of n one-dimensional spectral problem. So somehow which would separate the variable for this spectral problem. So the first work in the quantum case, well, the method that was proposed and which worked quite well in a lot of cases was proposed by Sklianin already in the late 80s. And the idea of Sklianin was the following, is that you can try to construct such a convenient basis of the space of state by considering some family of commuting operators, which typically will be one of the operators of the monodromy matrix. And if this operator satisfies some good properties, in particular, it should be diagonalizable with a simple spectrum, you can consider its set of roots that should be complete. And in that case, using this set of, operator roots, you can define a basis of the space of state in such a way, well, in the usual way. And this basis should also be constructed in such a way that the transfer matrix, when evaluated at this operator root, will act as simple shift on the basis element, so in that way. So, yes. So this is all the difficulty to define it clearly. But imagine that you have, for instance, B of lambda, I take, for instance, the simple case of the XX X chain. It's a polynomial in lambda. So it's lambda n plus sum for cn, n equals 0 to n minus 1. So yeah, I didn't have lambda n. So if all these operators are commuting between themselves, it means that formally you can try to write it as a product of so this is what I put this little, well, I don't know how to say it in English. And this B, this will be a set of commuting operators. So I don't know if you see with the, okay. So this is what I mean. Of course, this has to be put on a rigorous basis. But the idea is the following. But of course, you're family of B operators, there should be a family of commuting operators, and you should have the right degree of the polynomial and whatever, whatever. There are some lot of conditions for this to work. So this is just the idea. And in fact, for the XXZ chain with non-diagonal boundary condition, you can obtain rights, use such an the entry calligraphic B of the monodromy matrix, but for this entry to have the good properties, first of all you should deform the model with some inhomogeneity parameters, so that in fact you will have ensure to have that this operator has a simple spectrum. And also, you have to, and we will use not the operator B itself, but the operator of a generalized gauge transform model. I will explain why. And also, of course, there is some condition of the boundary matrices that they should have some non-diagonality conditions so that this work. Otherwise, if we are in the diagonal case, yes.
No, I'm wondering
In fact, the way Sklianin settled all this approach was by considering some analog of the classical case.
Yeah, but, so this X here are some kind of action variables or?
It's slightly more complicated than that. I will not be able to explain you here like this, or I will not be able to go on with the. You can have a look of the paper of Sklianin. Uh-huh. He's making the connection with.
I'm wondering if this
X of variable in the classical case.
Just wondering if these XGs they are like invariant under time evolution or it's evolving. These XGs, these operator roots, I'm wondering if those operators, they are invariant under time evolution or not.
They are the roots of the B operator, so... So
they don't commute with the T. Okay, I see.
No.
I see, thank you.
Okay, this was for the method of Sklianin, and I would like to mention that there have been recently another approach to construct such a basis, which in fact happens to be more general. It can be applied to some cases in which the Sklianin method does not work. And the idea is to use the multiple action of the transfer matrix itself on some well-chosen, generically chosen vector to construct the eigenstate. And I will give you the example in the just now, more details about the construction of this basis in the boundary case that we consider. First of all, in the Sclianin approach, the strategy is the following. The first step is to simplify the expression of the transfer matrix. I remind you that the transfer matrix is written as a trace of the monodromy matrix times the K plus matrix. So if you want to express it in terms of the element of the monodromy matrix, generically you will have a sum over the four operators. And when you want to diagonalize the transfer matrix, this is not convenient. So the idea is to make it at least triangular, and in fact you can even make it diagonal, by diagonalizing this K matrix. And for this, the idea is to use the vertex IRF, the trigonometric version of the vertex IRF transformation. So this was already the same idea as the paper of Cao and the collaborators who constructed this algebraic better than that solution. They already had this idea to make the transfer matrix simpler, the expression of the transfer matrix simpler by using this vertex IRF transformation. So, more specifically, what is the vertex IRF transformation? It's a relation between the R matrix of the six vertex model and the R matrix of the what I call here the, what is usually called the solid on solid model, which is a face model. And this R matrix depends on an extra parameter that I denoted by beta here, which is usually in the literature called dynamical parameters. So it happens that this R matrix does not satisfy the usual Young-Baxter relation, but some dynamical version of this Young-Baxter relation in which this extra parameter beta may be shifted by some Cartan of the algebra, like here. And the relation between the two matrices is given by some matrix S that has the following form in our case. And you see that there is this relation involves this shift of the beta parameter. And this matrix, vertex IRF matrix, also depends on another parameter alpha, which is just a shift of the spectral parameter. But we have the possibility to play with two parameters alpha and beta here, and this is what is important. And when you do that, you gauge transform all your boundary and bulk monodromy matrices. So you end up with some new operators that will depend on these two parameters alpha and beta. So you can have a most general transformation in this way. And the idea is to choose to fix alpha and beta such that you indeed have K plus diagonal. Well, the new gauge transform K plus diagonal, so that you have a simple form of the transfer matrix in this way. So in fact, it's A plus D, but D can be expressed in its turn in terms of A, so you have something like this, very simple. Now that you have this simple form, then you construct the basis, and you construct it in such a way that it quasi diagonalizes your new operator big gauge transform. So it does not diagonalize it exactly because of this dynamical parameter beta. So what does it mean? It means that the basis element that you manage to construct, when you act on B on this, you obtain nearly the same one, but with a shift of beta here. And this is due to this dynamical parameter that makes all the things much more complicated, unfortunately. So if you want to know the detail, you construct them explicitly in this way. So action of gauge or transform the operator with here a product of this vertex IRF matrix here, with a shift on the beta parameter, acting on the two usual reference state of the spin chain. And these basis elements, they are labeled by an n-tuple of variable h, which takes a value 0 and 1 here, and which correspond to two different possible shifts of the inhomogeneity parameter. In fact, you see that the zeros of this action, they are here at when lambda is equal to some inhomogeneity parameter with some shift. And what is nice is that you can show some. So in fact, the notation is a little bit misleading because these states are not at least if you consider the same beta, these states are not the dual of each other, but they are constructed in an independent way. But you can nevertheless show some orthogonality conditions, so they are nearly dual of each other if you want. Which is very important. So here it means that these two family of states are orthogonal when h and k are different, and when h and k are equal, this is given by some measures, which is basically a van der Monde determinant, which involves the shifted inhomogeneity parameter. So I insist that this construction works only on the inhomogeneous deformation of the model with inhomogeneity parameter, and in particular, there should be all difference up to the shift for this method to work, for this to be really a basis. And also, it needs to have this off-diagonal element of the boundary of the gauge transform boundary matrix to be non-zero. Otherwise, the operator B has not the nice property to have something. So it does not work for the chain with diagonal boundary condition, which is not the case for the new approach that has been proposed recently by Maillet and Nicoli. Well, you have still this condition on the inhomogeneity parameter, so this you cannot get rid of it. But then the two boundary matrices can even be taken diagonal, provided that they are not both proportional to the identity. And in this way, the SOV basis is constructed apparently in a very different way. You can choose some arbitrary covector S, and you act with some product of transfer matrices evaluated at this point here, given by the inhomogeneity parameter. And for the basis in the direct space, you do the same with some acting on some vector R, which is chosen with good orthogonality property with your previous basis. You can fix the normalization constant here. And if you fix it, it's uniquely defined. And it can be shown that, in fact, this basis satisfied also the good properties for separating the variable, and they still have the same orthogonality properties than in the previous case. And it was shown that in the particular case for where the two approaches are applicable, then in fact you can choose the S so that you obtain the same basis by this approach as the previous one. So now what you from both approach, whatever the basis you choose, then as I said, the multidimensional spectral problem for the transfer matrix that you can write especially on this basis with your wave function that a priori is a function of n parameter can be reduced to a set of n one-dimensional ones. It means that this wave function, in fact, can be written as a product of a function of one single parameters here, times this van der Monde determinant that is basically the measures of the that appears when defining the basis. And this state is an eigenstate of the transfer matrix if and only if this function Q together with the eigenvalue tau of the transfer matrix are solution, are together solution of a discrete version of the Baxter TQ equation. So it's a well-known Baxter equation, but written on a discrete set of values here, which correspond to the spectrum of this more or less to the spectrum of this B operator. So written in terms of the inhomogeneity parameter. And what is also nice is the eigenstates. So they are written in a completely separated form. So this is in this way. So it's a little bit more complicated here, but this is not very important, this coefficient here. And states which are written in this form, you can consider their scalar product. And due to these orthogonality properties of the two set of bases that you have obtained before, and that the fact that the measure is simply a Vandermonde determinant, you immediately obtain, it's very simple, a representation of the scalar product as a single determinant. However, there are problems. The problem is that both the description of the spectrum and this kind of determinant, they really depend explicitly on the inhomogeneity parameters, and it's really not non-simple to take the homogeneous limit and to go back to the physical model. And moreover, if you want to take the thermodynamic limit, so there is some extra work to do, and which is in fact the difficult part when considering this kind of model. First of all, to reformulate the spectrum into some more easy way to deal with. So the ideal things would be to reformulate it in terms of some usual TQ equation. So the question is the following. Can we characterize a class of maybe entire, maybe non-entire, we don't know, function sigma q, such that for each value of the transfer matrix, if each eigenvalue of the transfer matrix, there exists only one q belonging to this class of function satisfying with tau this functional equation. And on the contrary, as soon as there is a Q satisfying with some entire function tau, this functional equation, plus maybe some simple condition on tau, you get an eigenvalue of the transfer matrix. So this would be nice, but unfortunately, this is not known in general. So this problem could be solved maybe by the construction of the Q operator, but this is a very difficult problem. So Robert will speak a little bit about this this afternoon, I hope, but if I understand well, only in the diagonal case. Or you can try to have some analytical arguments, but at the moment, well, the general solution is not known. What is known is that you can reformulate it in terms, in general, in terms of a polynomial Q solution, of a polynomial in cosh 2 lambda, of this kind of equation, but with an additional term here, which is well chosen, so that in fact you have this polynomial Q solution that is vanish when it should vanish. And this additional terms depends on the boundary parameter. And you can show, in fact, the explicit correspondence with the SOV spectrum. And when F vanish identically, then you obtain some constraints, which are more or less the Nepomachis constraints. So I wanted to give you more details about that, but I'm afraid I have no time. So just what you just have to know about these slides is that you have two possibilities to obtain some usual TQ equation. One possibility is to have the Nepomachis constraints. It means to take this equals to zero. You probably recognize the Nepomachis constraint. The other possibility is to have this coefficient equal to zero, which means that you have at least one of the two boundary matrices, which is diagonal, which is in fact what we expect. And this is why a motivation why we choose to consider this special bound. In fact, here we have a complete description of the spectrum. We have no problem with the spectrum. So what about the eigenstate? In fact, it happens that in the range of Sklianin approach, they can be reformulated as generalized beta states. So in fact, this is even a general result for all separate state, not only eigenstate. And here, this omega is a complicated, a priori complicated vector, but it's a special separate state. And what happened is that with the special choice of alpha and beta diagonalysis K plus matrix, and moreover, if you add an additional constraint such that this off-diagonal element of some gauge transform K minus matrix is zero, so this means that this K minus matrix becomes upper triangular. So this, of course, this implies some constraint because you have already fixed alpha and beta, and then you add some more condition. So this means that you have some constraint on the boundary parameters, and in fact, this this is a special case of Nepomachy's constraint. Then, in that case, you can identify in a simpler form this this special separate state that you have here. And you, in fact, this is the same state as the one that was used in this work of Cao and collaborator who constructed the algebraic beta on that solution in this case. And it can be written as the action of the product of this this vertex IRF matrix on the usual reference state of the chain. So of course it involves some complicated the gauge parameter alpha and beta. So I denote this state in the following way. And what about the special case we consider here for the boundary K matrix at infinity? So in fact, we just consider this special case when we make these parameters tend to infinity, so that we have a very simple boundary matrix at infinity, which is diagonal, but which is not proportional to the identity. So in this case, since it is diagonal, we are out of the range of Sklianin's approach, but we are still in the range of the new SOV approach. So what we know is that we have still a complete construction of the eigenstate the approach in terms of such a polynomial Q. And in this case, this polynomial Q are solution of the homogeneous TQ equation because we are in the case of a diagonal matrix. So we get rid of this inhomogeneous term. And we can moreover show that with the special choice of alpha and beta diagonalizing K plus, we can directly compute the action of the transfer matrix of this generalized beta state. And we can show that it is still an eigenstate of the transfer matrix with the same eigenvalue as the eigenstate constructed by SOV. So they should be proportional to each other. So we can use this beta state representation of the right eigenstate in this way. And moreover, it's also a very simple case because the spectrum is the same as the one of an open spin chain with diagonal boundary condition, so with two boundary parameters. Which would be this one. So of course the situation here is different because these two boundary parameters, they parameterize a completely general boundary field on the first site, and in the chain with diagonal boundary conditions, these two boundary parameters, they parameterize the two boundary fields on the two opposite sides of the chain. But nevertheless, the spectrum is the same, so somehow it's also a simple case. So I will skip this part, but basically what we should know is that this kind of scalar product of between the separate states that I showed you before in terms of the inhomogeneity parameters, they can be transformed So the general expression is very complicated in general, but if you are in the case when you consider two polynomials with the same number of roots, and moreover one is an eigenstate of the transfer matrix with the constraint, so it satisfies the simple Betheu equation like this, then it's simply a Slavnov determinant. You recover the simple Jacobian of the transfer matrix eigenvalue. So we will use this determinant representation for the computation of the correlation function. And I don't know how much time, I'm not sure. How? Okay, thank you. So I will, I have the time just to tell you about the strategy to compute correlation function and the difficulties, because unfortunately there are some difficulties. So the strategy is the following. So we want to consider this kind of quantity. So the mean value in the ground state of some local operator acting on the first m site of the chain, and Q is the eigenstate of the transfer matrix corresponding to the ground state, written in the new SOV approach. So we have shown that it was proportional to a generalized Betheu state, at least the right one, because the left one is not the case, we keep it like this, but the right one can be written as a generalized Betheu state in this way. And so once you have this, you can use a similar strategy as the one that was used in the diagonal case to act with the local operator on these states. Means we decompose this boundary Betheu state as a sum of bulk Betheu state. We use the solution of the bulk inverse problem to act with local operators on the Betheu states. And then we reconstruct the result of this action as a sum over boundary state. And that then you can turn back to the separate state to go back to the, and then you can use the scalar product formula that was derived in the framework of SOV for the separate states. So in principle, this works, but there are some difficulties, and the main difficulty is due to the fact that we have to deal with this gauge transform algebra compared to the case with diagonal boundary condition. And the first difficulty is that it's very, very complicated to compute the action of the usual basis of local operators. So by usual basis, means usual matrix that have a one only at the site K and L, and A and J and a zero elsewhere. So we try to identify a basis whose action is simpler to compute. And the basis that we identify is the following. So it's a gauge transform version of this local operators here, but you have to choose the gauge parameter in a very precise way and quite complicated, so that you have indeed an action that is reasonable when you want to compute it. So this is not simple, as you see. So now what we did is we computed the elementary building blocks, means just the mean value in the ground state of the element of this basis. And the second problem is that we cannot compute, we were not able to compute any the mean value of any basis element. If the sum of epsilon prime minus epsilon, so epsilon, the parameterize the non-zero element of the local operator at the beginning, is not zero, then this induces some shift of the dynamical parameter beta when acting on this Betheu states, and we end with a state that is written on a SOV basis with shifted gauge parameter. And then, of course, this new SOV basis, we can no longer use the nice orthogonality properties with the left SOV basis, and we don't know how to compute the scalar product, the scalar product of this new state. So at the moment, we have no idea how to compute in a simple way this kind of matrix element. So we were obliged to restrict ourselves to matrix element for which this is zero. And in fact, the matrix element for which this is zero are just the matrix elements that are non-zero in the diagonal case, the one for which there exists the formula, because in the diagonal case, you have still the spin conservation, the conservation of the spin. So for this matrix element in the diagonal case, they are non-zero. Here, they have a priori no reason to be zero, at least in the finite chain. But okay, we have some. So this is obviously a more difficult problem. So for the matrix elements that we were able to compute, we obtain a formula that can be written as in the periodic case in the term of multiple integral in the half infinite chain limit. So what happened in the half infinite chain limit is that your set of beta roots condensate on some interval of the real axis with some density function rho lambda. And there is some possible contribution of some isolated complex roots, which may exist in the description of the ground state, depending on the boundary field of the model. These isolated complex roots, they are here because there are some poles or zero of the beta equation at this special point parametrized by the boundary parameter, so they may converge towards this pole or zero. So in the expression that you get, we obtain in fact an expression that is very similar to the one that we have in the periodic case. So I didn't write the explicit expression, but the only difference are here from the fact that the integrand depends on both boundary parameter plus or minus. Instead, in the diagonal case, we are only a dependence on one boundary parameter. And this is normal because in the diagonal case, we have a dependence only on the parameter at site one, and the boundary field at site one is parameterized by only one parameter. Instead, here, the boundary field at site one is parameterized, well, up to our normalization by these two parameters here. So we have the dependence in these two parameters, and this is expected. And also, the contour of the integration, they are this interval of the real axis, plus some contour around the boundary roots that may exist in the description of the ground state, depending on the different case of boundary fields that you consider. And you may have the contribution of two boundary roots, corresponding to these two boundary parameters instead of just one in the diagonal case. And once again, this is perfectly expected. And also, okay, we have some dependence on the gauge parameter, but for this, we have also dependence on the gauge parameter here in the kind of local operators that we consider. And I should mention that it's possible to take the limit, the diagonal limit, and to show that we obtain in fact the exactly the same expression as in the diagonal case, in diagonal limit. So I think I'm over. So I'm just conclude now with some perspective on open problems. Some of them I think are reachable in the near future. Otherwise, are really more complicated. And okay, maybe I thank you for your attention, and I will stop here.
Thank you. Any questions?
Yes.
Thanks for a very nice talk.
So just a comment, really, on the last but one issue of the form factors of local operators at a distance m. So, I mean, you're right that there's no solution of the quantum inverse problem in terms of the calligraphic A, B, and C, D, the you know, Sklianin's open monodromy matrix. But of course, there is a resolution in terms of the regular A, B, and
yes,
C, D.
Yes, yes, yes. In fact, you can try to use that. But you have to compute some boundary bulk scalar product.
Sure. But I was just going to say that within the Kyoto 95 approach, both of those operators are given in terms of the same free field realization. So there's nothing within that formalism that stops you computing such quantities.
And then you can obtain some form factor some dependence?
Yes.
Okay, I was not aware about that, so maybe we can discuss later.
Okay, thank you. And I'd just like to say that, you know, although the problem I'm talking about is complicated, I hope the talk won't be horrible, so it'll be complicated. So thanks for the advert.
Okay.
Yeah, so I understand that you send one of the ends of the chain to infinity. So how much the condition, the boundary condition at this end still influences what happens for the correlation function?
For sure, it will influence the description of the ground state, because we have shown in a previous paper that when you consider only diagonal boundary condition, also we computed the boundary magnetization. Also, you consider also your expression, explicit expression of the boundary magnetization does not depend on the boundary parameter at the other side of the chain. It still depends through it. Through the ground state, because I come back maybe to this expression to explain this. I have hidden in the, under the carpet, but here you have this contour that may surround the boundary root, and which give a special contribution when the ground state. So the question is whether or not the boundary in the diagonal case, that in fact you should compare the two boundary field. If one is bigger than the other, this will tell you whether the ground state contains or not and which boundary root the ground state should contain. And this makes some in the diagonal chain. We have shown that in the massive case, at least, you have in the thermodynamic limit, you have a discontinuity of the boundary magnetization when you keep the boundary field at one side of the chain fixed, and you change the boundary field at the other side. You have a discontinuity precisely when the two boundary fields are equal. So for sure, there is some influence. The question is whether there is an influence on the explicit expression, more than just on the description of the ground state. Well, the conjecture is that maybe not, but okay, since I cannot say any more about that, since we have not really tried to play with this in this case.
And if there is no other question, how does this, the position of this boundary beta root depends on the boundary conditions? Because I'm not familiar
so
with this.
I didn't write it, because in fact it is quite complicated. There are many cases to consider, but it's written in my paper with Sébastien Grisalva and Jacopo Denardis. So there are all the cases consider, so you can have a look. Okay, but So I just mean that this is the half infinite chain limit. We just send the boundary at site n to infinity. We take n to infinity, but we still stay close to the first site of the chain. We still consider correlation functions that are starting from the first site of the chain. So the you mean when you consider this, the problem is where do you consider your local spin operator? Because here I consider the local spin operator starting from site one. So they are really at the boundary and up to some site m, finite distance from one boundary. Of course, if you consider them in the middle of the chain, you will obtain something different. But yeah. In fact, the expression of the correlation, as I said, the expression of the correlation function itself, the analytical expression, does not depend on the boundary, even the other boundary, but it depends through the ground state, because through the configuration of the ground state. This is what I explained already. So I don't know whether we can say that we have a complete factorization. From this, the expression is clearly not depending on the other boundary. Well, at least in the periodic case, not periodic, in the diagonal case. As I said, I have not computed the completely generic non-diagonal case, but we may conjecture that maybe it is the same. But there is still a dependence through the ground state. Well, in fact, we were quite yes. Well, it depends how you take the thermodynamic limit. I mean, the way we consider it in our previous work is what you start from the finite chain, you compute the zero temperature correlation function. So you are in a mean value in the ground state. So the ground state is defined from the finite chain, and then you follow until the thermodynamic limit. So the question is that when you invert the two limit, when you take the thermodynamic limit first, going from temperature case and going after taking the thermodynamic limit to the zero temperature case, maybe I don't know. It seems that in that case, yes, you have a factorization when you have the transfer matrix approach. In fact, what you get from the quantum transfer matrix approach in the temperature case is a factorization. In fact, I don't really understand how you can obtain. It seems that there is a problem of inversion of limit. What? Yes, this is what I think. There is a problem. You have to invert these two limits, and probably it's not the same. So this is what I mean by. I am first in the ground state in the finite chain, and then I consider the limit of the formula.
My question would be because if I understand correctly, the integrand does not depend at all on the data of the other boundary field. So then, is it correct that if there would be some contribution stemming from the other boundary to the ground state in terms of some loop integral, then otherwise anyway it should give zero because there would be no pole, something like this, like in the periodic case where.
No, yeah, but the case in the periodic case, what happened is that in fact, if you make a careful analysis of the ground state, at least in the massive regime, you see that there is only one boundary route, which can be either the one at site one or the one at site n, and of course. The analytic expression and cycle only the pole of the one at site one. But whether it is here depends on the other boundary field at site N. So whether you have the contribution of these special boundary roots or not is depends on the field at infinity somehow.
Okay, let us thank the speaker again. Thank you.